you know, on the endothelial cells. What are these? Endothelial cells of pulmonary capillary beds. On the endothelial cells, there's a unique enzyme expressed. This enzyme is expressed on the surface of endothelial cells. That is why this enzyme is called ectoenzyme, because this is not intracellular enzyme. The cell is expressed on the surface of endothelial cells, right? Not released into blood. But now they believe that not only pulmonary capillaries have capacity to convert angiotensin 1 into 2, even some other capillary beds can also do this function. But for your level, you just remember that in the pulmonary capillary endothelial lining, they are expressing enzyme called, what is the name of these enzymes? You know, they are very angry because you don't remember where they are. You look at their expression. Right? These are which enzymes? Angiotensin converting enzyme. What they are doing? Actually, they are responsible to convert angiotensin 1 into angiotensin 2. This is a function of these enzymes. These are the function of these enzymes, which are called angiotensin converting enzymes, that they convert angiotensin 1 into angiotensin 2. And when we talk about the drugs like captopril, enalapril, lisinopril, or other angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors, those drugs basically bind with these proteins and block their function. When we say there are a whole group of drugs called angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitor, what is the function of those drugs? These drugs are basically bind with these enzymes and blocking their action. Every doctor knows that these enzymes are converting angiotensin 1 into angiotensin 2. But some good doctors know they do also one more function. What is the second function of these enzymes? There is another product in the blood which is called bradykinin. Bradykinin is broken down by these enzymes. Bradykinin, you know, look at it. Because it is inactivated. Bradykinin inactivation. Bradykinin is vasodilator. And angiotensin 2 is vasoconstrictor. So what is the function of this enzyme? These enzymes break down the vasodilators and produce vasoconstrictor. Of course, when blood vessels will constrict, blood pressure will go up. Am I clear? Now, so again, let's recap up to this. Patient was actively bleeding, right? It will take some time. Renal perfusion is reduced. Then blood pressure sensitive cells release renin. Plus, macula densa senses low sodium coming here, a sign of low GFR, that also forces the cell to release renin. Moreover, falling blood pressure activates the sympathetic outflow, and sympathetic fibers coming to the juxtaglomerular apparatus further release of renin. This renin is an enzyme which comes into general circulation and break down the angiotensinogen into angiotensin 1. And when angiotensin 1 is passing through the, mainly when it is passing through the pulmonary circulation, then angiotensin converting enzymes, which are normally expressed on the endothelial cells of pulmonary circulation, they convert angiotensin 1 into angiotensin 2. So they produce very powerful vasoconstrictor. And of course, these enzymes are very active, very intelligent. While they are producing vasoconstrictor, they don't forget to inactivate the vasodilators like bradykinin. Now we have the angiotensin 2 in our circulation. Now we have to see what angiotensin 2 will do in the body. What it should do? It should bring the blood pressure up and blood volume up. That was the problem, na? So now we see how angiotensin 2 is going to achieve its function. Let's come to the actions of angiotensin 2. First, we'll talk about the classical action. Number one, angiotensin 2, okay, I will draw here circulatory system in a little detail. The left heart, and these are the arterioles. From the aorta, these are the arterioles. And here is your right heart. This is the venous system. And of course, in between these arteriovenous system, there are, what are these? Capillary beds? I hope you must know. Blood comes from arterial side, passes through the capillary beds, and then it is drained to the venous side. Right? This is right heart and that is left heart. And of course, you will not forget to draw that there must be lung over there, that this is your pulmonary circulation. And blood gets oxygenated over there and then it comes to the left atrium. And of course, here is your, what is this? Air spaces. Clear? Now we'll see first of all, what is the action of angiotensin 2 on this system? Because pressure and volume is falling into the system. First of all, angiotensin 2 has receptors on the arteriolar smooth muscle. What are these? Arteriolar smooth muscle. Angiotensin 2 receptors are present on arteriolar smooth muscle. Plus, angiotensin 2 receptors are also present on the venular smooth muscle. So they are also present over here. Right? Now what really happens? Number one, angiotensin 2 will work on, what is this? Venous smooth muscle. When angiotensin 2 act on the angiotensin 2 receptors on venous smooth muscles, veins constrict. When veins will constrict, can blood remain pool into vein? No. Most of our blood is normally present in the veins. Veins contain about 70% of total blood volume. That is why we call them the vascular component with the highest capacity, or simply veins are called capacitance vessels. So angiotensin 2 will constrict the veins. When veins are squeezing, pressure in veins will go up and blood will rush towards where? Where the blood is going? To the heart and then to the eventually left heart. So under venoconstriction, blood going to the left heart is less or more. When you squeeze the vein, venous return to the heart is increased. Now listen, when blood flow increases to the left heart, it means cardiac filling is more. So venous return, venoconstriction lead to increased venous return, that lead to increased cardiac filling. Increased cardiac filling lead to increased end diastolic volume and increased end diastolic pressure. At the end of the diastole, volume and pressure is more in the ventricle. So ventricle is stretched. And according to Frank Starling law, more you stretch the ventricle, more it contract. Frank Starling law is stated that within physiological limit, more you stretch the myocardial cell, more they contract, of course, within physiological limit. Don't rupture them, right? Now, so whenever venous return is more, end diastolic volume is more, we say that preload on the heart is more. And whenever preload on the heart is more, preload is the amount of blood in the ventricle on which it has to produce contraction. Is that right? So, whenever there's more blood accumulated here, more it is stretched, more it contract, so stroke volume will become more. So that will lead to increase stroke volume. That will lead to increase stroke volume. And of course, when stroke volume is more, then what is there? Increased cardiac output. And when there is increased cardiac output, that will lead to increase in systolic blood pressure. That was the point we wanted to reach. You know, our systolic blood pressure was falling as well as diastolic blood pressure was falling. When your bleeding was going on, for example, bleeding was from here, so blood pressure was falling. So by venoconstriction and increasing the venous return to the heart and increasing the end diastolic volume and of course increasing the contractility and increasing the stroke volume, resulting into increased cardiac output, eventually increases systolic blood pressure, because systolic blood pressure mainly depends on cardiac output. Am I clear? During the systole, blood pressure will go up. Meanwhile, angiotensin 2 will also work on, what is this? Arterial smooth muscle, and arterioles will constrict.